Thank you for joining the presentation. We are going to give on the use of in-memory data grid for electronic banking, for retail electronic banking. Traditionally, we use, I would say, in-memory data grid already for financial markets. I think this is one of the first times we start using it for retail banking. My name is Lieven Merks. I'm working already a long time for ING, 32 years. And that gives you a very nice historical perspective. So it shows you when we started, 64 kilobyte was a really big machine. Today, 600 gigabyte. Okay, it's a standard server. Also, the interesting thing is that I was able in all my career so far to follow every time there was a new technology. And you see that a lot of these patterns and a lot of the problems we try to solve are not really new. So the purpose is to give you an idea, who are we, what kind of is our strategy, why is in-memory data grid something we need for ING, our challenges, because things become more complicated as a bank, and also what kind of application patterns are we trying to implement, is what kind of combination of in-memory data grid and memory compute is the best opportunity for us, and what did we learn from this exercise. The purpose is to give you a realistic insight, I would say the bad, the good, and the ugly of what we did. And maybe it's a one-shot presentation, I don't have to come back afterwards. So first of all, something more about the ING Group. Before the financial crisis of 2007-2008, we were very expanding, very growing fast, worldwide scale. We were positioning ourselves with ING Direct. And then we got hit hard, I would say, by the financial crisis. After that, we had to recover. But now we are really working on, I would say, embracing IT, embracing software. We consider us more and more today as really a software company with the kind of financial services that we deliver in that context. What we seek there is that instead of having, I would say, bankers at one side and IT at the other side, is to create one squad, one Scrum group working together to deliver new technologies, new possibilities. And what you see is that we don't necessarily concentrate on creating new banking products, but we change the way we want to deliver that. To deliver that as frictionless, as easy, and as fast as possible, and to engage in new technology. Meaning if tomorrow blockchain has a business case for us, we want to be ready to use it. So I think our ambition today, we have about 37 million customers. We want to go to 100 million customers. We are setting up an engineering culture where we say, okay, innovation is important. We stimulate IT to come with new things. We are ambitious in the way we reorganize. So with the words of Schwarzenegger, I think we can say we are back. So I'm working for ING Belgium, so we are a market leader in our own country for that purpose. We have about 2.5 million active customers, where the primary relationship is with 1.2 million customers. What is our strategy? I think is that we really want to make life easier for our customers. We really want to concentrate on the fact that you can use our applications anywhere. And we see as our competitors, fintech companies like Google, Facebook, which are also maybe thinking about becoming a bank tomorrow. If that happens, where are we? We really want to take the lead, what we call in digital banking, and presenting ourselves as a kind of integrator there. This is a slide of our strategy. Our communication department always likes when we present that in our presentation. But I'm also presenting this here to show a bit where is the important thing for us. So first of all, our mission is to say, okay, we want to empower people to get ahead in life and in business. So we address the people in their private life, address the people in their business continuity. So we try to offer them information and services that really help them. And that means also that one of the primary directives we have is that we need to be prepared for the future. And we want to deliver that kind of service everywhere, anytime. Meaning you should always be available. If you see today on your mobile device, you've got more and more applications where you want to integrate with. Today, maybe you still have to type a SEPA debit account, a credit number, an account number. Already today, we have some applications like Payconiq where you say, ah, okay, I got my contact list. I want to pay to that email address. And he makes the relationship between the email address and the account number that's behind it. So you make it as frictionless, as easy to use as possible. But things get complicated. Things become more difficult to manage. Even without having more ambitions than we have today, electronic banking, mobile is growing 25% capacity each year without doing something specific. We see if we migrate a customer from a browser user to a mobile user, the number of times he contacts the bank is multiplied with a factor of 7, with the number of interactions that this bringing. So you can imagine what this means on the load of your existing systems. You have an evolution that we call open banking, meaning that information in the bank, the account information, the operation that happened in the bank, is that you have to expose this to external companies who want to use that as an intermediary to the customer because they want to go multi-bank, but also because you have a directive coming from the European Commission, the PSD2, which says, okay, banks have to open up and expose the information. So somewhere you suddenly add an unpredictable factor to the load that is coming to your systems. In Belgium, we got an additional complexity because we come from a traditional branch environment. So we have about 800 branches. And for the time that they implemented that, let's say 20 years ago, they were already very ahead in their time and they create a kind of partitioning, sharding, meaning the customer data for that branch was in that branch. So if you do an operation, if you want to retrieve the information there, it was in the branch. Now we say we stop this kind of fat client applications. We want to make it a web server centralized application, meaning that 6,000, 7,000 users which are working and using this application from 9 o'clock in the morning to 5 o'clock in the evening suddenly become also extra load on your existing system. If you're already servicing today 9,000 users in parallel, suddenly you had 6,000 users, internal employees to the same systems. Also, we see every time we go to our backends through a number of layers who do the transformation of the data, be it in a COBOL format to XML to JSON format, we create additional delay in that interaction. It's about 200 to 300 milliseconds delay. We made already some theoretical calculations. Is okay, suppose that we upgrade our mainframe and we have more capacity, can we reach that? We made a theoretical calculation, can we go times 3? And the answer is simply no. We have reached a bit the upper limit of our scalability. Our applications on the legacy, on the mainframe, are very well architectured for the past. They already implement a microservice architecture, even before the word existed. But besides that, they are single instance running in one central place. And then our infrastructure department came with the next challenge. They say, guys, forget about Sun clusters, AIX clusters, window clusters. We are not going to do that anymore. So tomorrow you receive a standard Linux box, and you have to work with that one. Meaning where infra in the past gave our high availability for free and the application didn't have to care about it. Now they say, okay, we don't do it at infrastructure level anymore. Solve it at software level. Luckily, you see a number of software components being developed that handle that kind of high availability without needing very specific hardware. A second consequence is, for example, also today we are in Brussels with two data centers, 5 kilometers apart. We act as one logical data center. They are connected with a number of fibers in a loop. So at the same time that we have a high availability solution, meaning something fails and something else takes over, we have at the same time a DRP solution because the availability right side or the left side are in different data centers. That was nice for the past. Tomorrow, European Commission says, yeah, guys, two data centers in the same city, only 5 kilometers apart, we cannot do that anymore. It should be at least 15 and maybe even 50 kilometers apart, meaning that something that was synchronous before suddenly has to become asynchronous. And of course, we want to reach A4 availability, meaning if we want our service always to be available, we can permit ourselves a few minutes downtime per month, but that's it. And whatever happens, no transactions lost. And besides that, of course, you have our customer who is becoming more demanding that it should be easy to use, it should work always, it should be easily integratable. And I guess you notice also, you take the train, you take the bus, what is everybody doing? Not reading their journal, they are on their mobile. Everything happens on a mobile. So from an architecture point of view, we decided, okay, we need some extra building blocks, we need some platforms on which we can build our future applications. So we decided, first of all, to use GridGain as an in-memory computing technology. We have chosen that based on, I would say, the fact that it combines from the start in-memory computing and in-memory data grid, and it's open source. On top of that, we created a layer that we called shielding. And the purpose of that is to really create a kind of ring fence, a protection layer for our legacy environment. Take the frequent load of our mainframe applications so they can concentrate on the real transaction processing. Besides that, we have some long-living processes, if I can call it like that. Is, for example, if you have to do a payment, you have different steps to go through. You have to collect the data, you have to arrange the signature, you have to verify the available saldo, and you need additional steps. These kind of processes, the moment we capture the transaction, even without committing it to the backend, we want to be sure that we don't lose the transaction, whatever happens. With these building blocks, we are also able to build other kind of applications where the master data is not more residing on our Unisys backend, but is really residing on the GridGain level itself. So how are these components a bit working together? If you look at the right side, most of these technologies are very recent, the past few years in the banks. I think it's a lot of technology we wouldn't dream about, I would say, 5 years ago. And also all this kind of technology is evolving very rapidly. So you take a lot of responsibility as a bank trying to integrate this stuff. To give one example, the Kafka event bus that we use, it's not even a version 1.0. It's still a version 0.9, 0.10. And an API working in 0.9 is not guaranteed to work in 0.10. So instead of saying, I buy a mature product from a big vendor, I'm engaging now in open source software, have the people inside are able to integrate this kind of stuff and are able to support it in the future also. What you see also in our evolution is that everything becomes REST API based. Because we think the API layer, first of all, it removes a big part of a single point of failure, which is the middleware. It creates point-to-point connection. It's very efficient. And if you want to open to the outside world, it's really REST API, which is the future. So how are the building blocks working together? We have an authentication layer, which should be able to support several means of authentication. We have strong authentication, we have authentication by mobile, we have authentication by the using of DigiPass. We have a front-end layer, and which is running a lot of times. One part is running in the browser, because we are using single-page application frameworks like Polymer, like Angular. And we have created a layer which is providing what we call presentation APIs. The data you provide to the outside layer is oriented at the way you want to present it or do you want to consume it. Inside, we use what we call capability APIs, meaning you ask a certain execution of a business logic, do a payment from A to B. behind that, you have a lot of orchestration sitting behind it, which is the real execution. We use grid gain in two layers here. One layer is to say, okay, we create the long-living process orchestration at that layer, and we create a layer for exposing the data which comes from our backends. Just to clarify a bit the difference, what is for us ISAP interactive customer experience process, is to say, okay, we expose an experience API to the outside world and we use the capability API. We do the orchestrations, or for the shielding is the purpose is to say, okay, the data that was residing on our backend, we aggregate it, we transform it, and we expose it fit for use case where we really need it. The challenge is, of course, how do you ensure that this data remains consistent, is up to date, and is always available? If you look to our standard approach so far for electronic bank purposes, is we have a front-end layer running in the browser, with a Java microservice architecture in the front, a network zone, just to separate for security reasons, that from the real backend layer and the transformation layer. Historically, we were using TIBCO BusinessWorks as a middleware for transforming the data, which was copybook oriented, to an ESB kind XML-based service. What do we want to do now? Is we really want to bring all this data, market data management, account information, one layer closer to the consuming application. Very simple. Meaning, all the latency that we had here before disappears, the transformation, we don't need to do it. And also, the way we present the information here is fit for purpose of the consumer and not necessarily the classical form in which it's stored in the backend. Honestly, we would like to go further. We would even like to push that layer there. The only thing that is stopping us from doing that today is security. It means that in what we call a semi-trusted network zone, you push all the data of your customers. And for the moment, that's not a risk we want to take, as we don't yet fully trust the way we are developing applications. Can we really create that kind of security? Because normally in this layer, you have temporary data for a single session, for a single customer. If you lose that, okay, there is certain damage, you're not dead in the water. If you would put all the information there and you would suddenly have a security breach, then you have a real serious problem as a bank. But for performance reasons, that's the layer we would like to reach. So I think we started rather humble with the first implementation, is to say, okay, we want to push some data to the first layer, and there we use it as a session store, meaning one application has to get the information when it's needed, it puts it in a kind of sideway cache, and consume it during this duration of the session of the user. Means that start up your session is probably slow, after that it will get quicker. It still has the big dependency on your backends, which are still classical A3 availability, and when you want to reach A4, you cannot do magic beyond that. It still is the old paradigm, bringing the data to the compute layer, as you really have to extract and bring it there. There's network overhead, there's a lot of intermediaries, and when you say a lot of intermediaries, you say a lot of points where things can fail. And it's a pull approach, meaning at the moment you need the information, you're going to get it. And because it's based on Cassandra for the moment, we are also limited to single key queries. So that's working fine, but we want to go beyond that because this approach doesn't really offload a lot our backends. So we are taking this a step further. The session cache still plays its normal role for the duration of the session. But the real target here is to say, okay, the system of records, we bring it closer to the consumer and we transform it. Meaning that the data, even before the customer is there, it's already in the cache. It's already transformed, it's already available, and it's up to date. The availability, it doesn't depend anymore on your backend. It depends on your grid gain cluster availability. There you have a lot of possibilities to create high availability, high redundancy. Also, if we have to do transformation here, or we have to do consult different caches, you can do it close to where the data is residing. So you can really use the affinity and the co-location of the compute and the data. You have less network overhead, less intermediaries, less single point of failures. And you can use a push approach, meaning that once the data is changing here, you push it there, and you guarantee that you can reach it there, and the information is up to date. Also, the way you want to exploit this data extends. So where do we use this shielding pattern for? We use it to store temporary data. If an application really needs to create a list of data that he wants to exploit for a certain user, he can do it. The session data, of course. But then the most important thing is we have a copy there of the reference data that we need for all the customers, in fact. In our logical architecture building block approach, we have what we call the distribution layer, the customer-centric core layer, and then the fulfillment layer where we locate our product engines. So the data, which is normally residing in the lower layers, we bring it up to the customer-centric layer and we bring it to the channels where we really need it. What are the physical components we use to implement that pattern? So we have the cluster with the different data caches and we use Cassandra as a persistent store. We use Cassandra because it's a key value store. It was ready available. Why not use it for that purpose? For pushing the events from our backends to the consuming layers in the caches, any mutation that happens on our customer data, we push through that layer, we use the Kafka bus. Why the Kafka bus? Because also it offers us an additional possibility, the guarantee that the data is there and will be available. And at the same time, we can subscribe in different places. So if tomorrow you want to run that in two data centers and keep both data locations up to date, you have just two subscribers to the same Kafka cluster. Sometimes we still use, I would say, what we call lazy load. You load the information once you need it, and then maybe you forget it. Or, okay, we have loaded this data for this customer. Now we know we have to keep it up to date. We still use the middleware that we have already implemented before. So this was a bit the patterns for electronic banking. Now there is also another use case, what we call SEPA direct debit. What is a direct debit for those who are not at home in the banking world, I would say, is that you have, for example, a supplier, your electricity company, that regularly delivers electricity to you and you have to pay each month, every quarter, your electricity bill. So how do they interact with you as a customer? Give a mandate to the bank as a destination to say, okay, if this creditor comes with this long list of debits he wants to execute, 100,000, 1 million debits you want to execute, you take it over and you have the mandate to execute that for all the debtors in there. So why did we start thinking about using, I would say, memory data grid and memory computer grid also there? It's because we have some ambitions there. We want to go further on what we already did today. Is if we receive today big files with about 1 million transactions, tomorrow we won't even have to bigger companies sending us files maybe with 10 million transactions, and we still should be able to handle it. Also, today we have a cutoff time that we say to the customer, guy, you have to deliver this file before a certain hour, otherwise it's the next day. We want to bring that closer to the cutoff time of the settlement agency that is in between. So that means that the time we need to do this calculation and all the processing becomes smaller. We want to be commercial competitive. And most of the times our customers are looking for a later cut-off time during the day. Of course, the solution we put in place should be payable. And it means that we cannot continue on our current platform because it becomes more and more expensive to push the capacity forward. And also, the information we collect for these direct debits is consulted by different parties. It's consulted by the creditor who wants to know where are all the execution of my debits going, but also the debtor, he wants to know what is my financial forecast? What do I have expect to pay in the coming months? How does it look like? Meaning that we have a lot of queries coming to this data. The more you expose this information, the more it's used. And of course, like I said already before, European directive, banks have to open up. This data will be collected by a lot of different parties. Interesting to know is that we are not doing that only for ING Belgium. We are doing that for other banks of the group, meaning that we are a central hub processing all these transactions and direct debits. Meaning that at a certain moment, we had a huge increase of load, the number of transactions we had to process. We went from 10 million per month to 100 million per month, meaning that the existing application would be able to handle that. That was still a bit sustainable, but also we suddenly have a lot more load, customers querying for this kind of information. So we got about, I would say, 500,000 queries per day coming to this system, meaning that the customer expects real-time response times, and you're really hitting the back end, which is the same, which is doing the transaction execution, which prefers to do transaction execution and not really responding to all these requests. So we want to process more files, we want to process more transactions. And we expect also this data will be more and more used. If it remains on our legacy mainframe, it will not be easy to expose it. So behind the reason of availability performance, there is also the question of openness inside the company itself. If you want to use this for analytic data, and you want to really to look at that information while the customer is there, and don't forget, the customer doesn't come to your branch anymore, and he's sitting 15 minutes talking to a branch agent, which knows him intimately, and he knows what kind of products he needs. He's there in his mobile, his session is about 2 minutes, and you need to give him relevant insights and information that are personal and interesting for him. So if you have to collect all the data all over the place at all different backends, you're much too late, the customer is gone, you have missed your window of opportunity. So all this flow looks like. We receive a lot of XML formatted files, ISO 20022, for all those that know it. On a peak period, we can have about 5,000 files landing on the system. Suddenly, you have to treat it. And in a peak day, it can contain 16 million transactions. And then you got a few number of hours to process it, to execute it, and before the cutoff time. So we try to parallelize two aspects. One aspect is to say, okay, we have all these files, so per file consistency, we do parallel processing. And once we have verified the consistency of the files, we do a parallel execution of the transaction. So if you receive a number of files, you split off the consistency checks, and then you split off the transaction processing. And there, you really gain the benefit of in-memory computing. And of course, all this information, as it is executed, this state of execution should be consultable real time. So we did a proof of concept. What did we learn? I would say that the good news is that we were able, on a small configuration, small Linux cluster of about, I think, 3 nodes, yeah, and a small memory because it's much more CPU-oriented, we were able to execute the 10 million transactions per hour that we wanted to reach. So that's already a good sign, and we have seen in previous presentations that the scalability is really horizontal when you need it. Failover is certainly an important aspect there also. If one of the nodes of the cluster is failing, the other one can take over and can continue to work. We are going to work with Oracle as a backend, not with for the persistent store, not Cassandra, because for Cassandra it's difficult to create a snapshot, a backup in moment in time. So we are going for Oracle Store. From a GridGate point of view, it doesn't make much difference if you're working with Cassandra or with Oracle. And for monitoring integration, we integrated with Elasticsearch, Grafana, and things like that. Now, some lessons learned. What have we learned? Which mistakes did we make? What good things did we do? First of all, when we started with the grid gain cluster, we thought, okay, if we have one big cluster for a lot of applications, then we have the maximum benefit. Every time we add a machine, everybody gets more capacity, so no problem there. So we were running two kinds of processes within the same cluster, the business execution, the workflow of the processes, and the data caches that we are having in memory as a copy of the mainframe systems. So our initial design looked a bit like this. You have one cluster and you have different activities. One node is more oriented at the data and the other node is more process oriented. So it went well until a certain moment, I would say. Positive aspect is operational management is very simple. You don't need many people looking at all different clusters. It's one team that can maintain it. As long as you have also not too many teams deploying applications which are synchronized when they deployed, everything worked fine. But then we learned something that we didn't know before, because we are discovering a bit this technology. Is first of all, we cannot treat as the grid gain hosting environment as a multi-tenant, multi-application environment. If you deploy applications there, it should be one shot, it should be consistent, and you bring the cluster up with all the code the same on all the nodes. You cannot take the risk of upgrading one node while the other one is running an older version. At the same time, we got more business journeys. We were, I would say, successful with the first implementation. Suddenly, we want to do more. We want to create more business journeys for our electronic banking channels. We had also much more teams trying to use this application. So then trying to be agile, deliver every 2 weeks a new version in production, and at the same time have one consistent image across grid gain, you cannot maintain that. So what is a bit the next step that we took is to say, okay, we are going to split our one big cluster in 3, 4 or even more different clusters. Because then a software upgrade is much easier to do. You can bring one cluster down without impacting the other. Each team can deploy at its own speed. And of course, yeah, you have to pay somewhere for the operational management. But again, in this case where you have business teams and they want to deliver each at the maximum speed their new applications, their new versions, is the only way to manage it. So I think we learned a bit the hard way. The Conway principle is that your software architecture somewhere reflects always your organization architecture and the way people interact together. What is another point we learned is that we are using the services invocation inside the grid gain cluster. And we try to create a kind of microservice architecture within the cluster itself. I think it's for obvious reasons, because if you do that, then you don't have all the overhead which normally comes with an HTTP REST service based microservice architecture. Because the binary communication between a consumer and a producer of data is just based on the Java Pojo object. You don't deserialize it, you don't set up an HTTP connection, you don't set up an SSL connection, and you don't have all that kind of overhead. And of course, the applications can directly use the cache without going through an API layer. We discovered there was security implemented already today on computing tasks. So you can fire off computing tasks in the grid gain cluster and it will verify authentication. You can protect caches for read, write, and read, write only, but there was no protection yet or security mechanism for services. So at our request, and that shows, I would say, the flexibility of this company to help us, they created this in a new version because they agreed it was somewhere missing in their architecture because security was already implemented for the other components. But still, what we need there is, for example, you have a new version of a certain service and you want to change it somewhere in that microservice architecture that you have. The only way you can do it today is to say, I upload a new code, I bring the complete cluster down, and I bring it back up again. If you have an HTTP microservice architecture, you can bring each component down and upgrade it on the fly. So there, I think we need some more extension, more flexibility, on how do we want to do a service discovery. If A needs to invoke a service B, can we discover which is the most recent version? And how can we assure that this one is loaded in memory and ready for use? There are already a lot of people, I think, that mentioned co-location. Co-location of data and compute. If you look at the way we would traditionally work, is to say, okay, you have your execution at one node, you have your cache A there, you have your cache B there, and this application needs to consume the data, then you really have to pay attention how you do it. You have to pay attention always your affinity key allocated, and you have to take that into account. You have to take into account that the affinity key A and B, if they are used in similar cases, they should be residing on the same nodes. But the real message behind this one is GridGain is a very powerful tool. You can do a lot of stuff. You can do very performant realizations with this. But if you don't really understand what is GridGain doing behind the screen, behind the API layers that you're using, you probably come out with a worse performance than if you would not be using this technology. So, in fact, it's a good recommendation to say you need really, at this stage, still senior developers to understand what's going on, who can help to implement these kind of use cases. So we did also a very basic test on in-memory computing. If we compare it to our classical use case, the application server working with, for example, the relational database, with the Cassandra database, you see that easily you gain in performance for retrieving the data, 73%, and also on the total computing result. Also the fact that you can do a distributed query where you say, okay, the result is partitioned over different nodes, collect the data, combine that in another way. It gives you a clear advantage compared to what you do normally. So, a bit as a conclusion. What went well? What can be improved? Like somebody already mentioned in previous presentations, it's easy to get started. You download GridGain or, let's say, Ignite. And just for mentioning, Apache Ignite is the open source version. GridGain is a commercial version. Commercial version adds data center replication, it adds security, a lot of other stuff you use as a company. If you want really to get started, you download the open source version, you put it on your laptop and you start developing. It's really easy. We found good documentation, basic examples. What we were missing is probably more complex examples because they show the basic functionality. And again, there the profile of a senior developer is very important. If you want really to remain product independent and you just want to use the cache functionality, you can standardize on the GSR interface of a cache. But most of the time, if you really want to use GridGain for the computing, okay. You have a certain vendor lock-in using their APIs, their possibilities. The fact that it's open source protects you better than it would have been, I would say, a commercial product where you cannot escape from. So what also went well is the use of GridGain in combination with Cassandra. It proved to be performant, it proved to be stable. It was very recently that the Cassandra interface was added, I think 6 or 8 months ago. So we didn't have any issue with that. Also, don't forget, we started with this kind of technology August last year. So we have a lot of ambitions to go further with this one. I have to say our collaboration with the company was excellent. If you're used to get working with big companies, without mentioning any names, you have 5 layers of support desk you have to go through to really ask a technical question, and then you get maybe an answer. So in this case, we could ask the senior developers to come to our company to help us to debug the code. Are we working correctly? Are we using this in the correct way? What we were still a bit lacking also is, I would say, the best practices, the best patterns, because discovering multi-clustering, single cluster, it was a bit our own experience. Somewhere there should be also standard enterprise patterns, the way you want to use GridGain and what kind of use cases you have there. So for the electronic banking part, we are really using the in-memory data grid because it offloads our mainframe and it provides us all the information as fast as possible for all electronic banking applications. For executing a workflow, you don't really need this kind of computing facilities. So in-memory data grid is there the more essential point that we use. For the use case of the execution of SEPA Direct Debit, it will be a combination of both. Because at a certain moment, we want to execute these 100 million transactions per month or 10, 15 million per day. And that's a lot of compute intensive. But at the same time, we want to keep 14 months of direct debits online information that can be queried by the user. So if we translate that to memory capacity for 14 months, it comes to, I think, 6 TB. It's a lot of information if you want to keep that in a cache. So we were also evaluating GridGain Ultimate Edition, which makes a new combination of the way the data is maintained in memory or on the persistent store. Because normally, the previous version of GridGain forces you to have everything in cache before you can start multi-indexing, before you can start using the SQL interface. So the new version also enables you to have only maybe the most recent information in your cache and the rest in the persistent store, without you as a programmer need to be defining two interfaces, one for your real-time cache and one for your long-duration cache. And after, I would say, 32 years of experience, the real difference is see that you have skilled engineers to support and deploy this kind of technology. Because it's a great weapon, but you can shoot yourself in the foot if you don't pay attention. That's my story. Questions? Yes?
Even you solve the idempotency problem
with the grid? The idempotency.
Yep.
So indeed, if you capture a transaction, how do you make sure it's once and only once executed? Because also, if you want to really work asynchronously, it's not so easy. So what we do most of the time, and that's also not a new pattern, is that already our backend patterns or backend mainframes are detecting doubles. If a double happens, they will raise an alert and even go back to the customer, was that really what was happening? Somewhere we have difficulties. We cannot use eventual consistency. You need to be consistent at the time itself. So somewhere we need guaranteed delivery between what you captured in the GridGain level, put it on Kafka once and only once, and then get it back in the mainframe once and only once. If worse things happen, still can be that you have a double execution, but then the application is already recovering from that one. But you have it also in the opposite sense. Your customer database is continuously updated. We have, I think, 1,000 mutations per hour going through our customer database, somebody changing mobile number, somebody changing his address, things like that. You also need absolutely to guarantee that any mutation, any change, it gets replicated there, because otherwise you will get out of sync. And if you really want to do a full sync again, it's a very lengthy operation. So there again, you need to be absolutely guaranteed that once and only once delivery is happening. There is a new evolution in Kafka that can guarantee better this once and only once delivery. On our backends, we are already running a transactional middleware, which we developed ourselves, which guarantees, okay, you accumulate transactions, and you can always say, I replay the transactions of that day. An example we did for the year 2000 is, certain moment we had our customer database, and there was an error. We cleaned the database, we recovered the backup of the day before, and we replayed all the transactions and all the mutations on that, and we were back in the state where we wanted to be. So our intention is to use Kafka in the same sense. Other questions?
For persistency, you use Cassandra. Do you find differences that you have to change the data model between the Cassandra and the one you use in the read, or they're pretty much
But the only purpose where we use then Cassandra is to have a persistent store. So a key value model is enough. In the value, you can still say, yeah, you can still say I use a POJO, a binary serialization, or I use, for example, a JSON serialization. Most of the time, we use a POJO binary serialization. But we don't exploit the data from Cassandra itself. It's just to say, okay, cluster crashes, it comes back up again, you can load the data from there. In the use case where the master data is stored in the gridgain cluster, then we need a point-in-time recovery, meaning that the nightly backup and the incremental execution of the transactions should bring you back to the point where your application may be a logical error. And there we use Oracle. And in Oracle, our intention is to store it not in a binary form, because then you cannot see is my data now correct or not, is to use it in a JSON serialized form. But there we still have to do execute performance testing. Other questions? Yeah?
Do you have any ambitions to move to a cloud architecture?
Could you repeat the question?
Do you have any ambitions to move to a cloud architecture, something like AWS?
For the moment, we have created our, we have different initiatives. We have created our ING private cloud internally, and we have an external provider providing us the internal cloud. At the same time, we start using more and more applications in the cloud. So for the moment, I think for most critical applications, we prefer to remain between the walls of ING. So we'll be...
Are you hosting your
gridgain
clusters on the cloud?
Yeah, yeah. But it depends also on the evolution, because some years ago, it was unthinkable as a bank to put something in the cloud. Now more and more companies like Salesforce, ServiceNow and things like that guarantee the security that we need, and also the security that we need to prove on our regulator. Is everything in order? Is all the data encrypted? Can it not leak information? So I think there was also a question in the back. But for the moment, a lot of the data is not yet completely partitioned. We have a primary node and we have backup nodes, but it's not partitioned and fragmented. So for the moment, the service is going where the primary node is located. The compute tasks are more flexible in that sense, is that you can use already the affinity to go to the co-location. I don't think we addressed already all the co-location issues. And within a service grid, it's not easy. The compute task, which is another technology from gridgain on the same grid, is more fine-tuned for that purpose. So why are we doing services and not compute tasks? It's because compute tasks gives you the possibility to say, okay, this kind of Java class, execute it where it needs to be executed. But that means also that in our data layer, you open up to all the other applications saying, fire off the code that you want on this layer. And that's somewhere a security risk as a bank we don't want to take. So we have created a service abstraction there. And that service abstraction should be able to do the computing task or find the right location, even if it's not at the right location. So we didn't find the final solution there yet. Other questions? No? Okay, thank you very much for your attention.